For the next talk, we have Thomas Fricke here, who is hacking containers and Kubernetes. So as I learned from him with a little chat up front, it's a little effort to hack it, but it's also a little effort to write a few lines of code to protect it. So applause for Thomas Fricke.
Yeah. Welcome, everybody. So let's go into the details. That's me. I'm partner, and I have been CTO at EndoCode, and now I have the title of the chief cloud wizard, which means absolutely nothing, but describes mostly what I do. I've dealt a lot with system automation, DevOps, cloud databases, and software architectures, so that's what you can ask me about. Personal history is I have more or less the time from the Apple II to Atari, then digital OSF Unix, and I've been using Linux since 0.95, actually. So I'm pretty old and have a long history. And by the examples, I think you will notice that a little bit. Okay. A disclaimer, we have partnered with CoreOS, which has been bought by Red Hat, which has been bought by IBM, with Red Hat themselves and Google. So our business is consulting, trainings, workshops, and audits on Kubernetes. And this talk is not about the Kubernetes code audits. It's just about what, from a user perspective, you can find in Kubernetes and where you have to be careful and what you can do to protect this entire ecosystem. So the history of Kubernetes is exciting. The project has developed really fast, and with really fast, I mean, in 2013, there was nothing like this. There was the Borg project in Google, and in 2014, they published it, and immediately IBM and Red Hat joined and forced it. Then it was a little bit of testing how it works. We did our first Kubernetes application in 2015. This was telephony in the Amazon cloud with all the G10 stuff, so Grundgesetz Article 10, which protects your communication. Then we went into the design pattern mode, Helm came out, and then a lot of training started. It was like introducing beginners to Kubernetes. And from the history, you see the Borg system. You have the elderly might remember 7 of 9 in Starship Voyager and Star Trek The Next Generation has been the Borg. So 7 of 9 is inspired the 7 spokes at the wheel of Kubernetes. So it's actually the friendly Borg system. So this is an internal joke. Started with security trainings. In 2016, all the applications more or less have been toy applications. This has to change in the last year. People came to us from security critical environments. This means energy control, trading, traffic control. And at this moment, we recognized it's time to make Kubernetes and the entire ecosystem really secure. And the talk is how you can do it. And maybe I want to inspire you to look into the stuff on your own and get a real impression on that. So this is where Kubernetes runs at the moment. And I missed the back ends of the car industry, and I even know some projects which I don't support in the surveillance industry. Face recognition in Kubernetes for airports is actually something I don't like, but it's hosted by some of the usual suspect companies. For those of you who have not heard about Kubernetes, it's a Greek, the official is a Greek, it's a Greek word for helmsman, same root as governor and cybernetic. And for you, what is important is it's 100% open source. It's written in Go. You can change it on your own. You can install it. You can compile it. It's not a product, as a Linux kernel is not a product. Some people make products out of it. So the main message is Kubernetes manages applications and not machines. This are slides from Google. So this is a 10,000 foot view. On the left side, you have the user clients, which connect with API or command line interfaces or user interface. Then you have the master servers, which only have data which is persistent in the etcd part. The etcd is a distributed database. And you always talk only to the API server, and everything is stored in the etcd. So all your secrets, configurations of the entire cluster, the state of the cluster is in the etcd. Schedulers and other controllers are starting processes, and on the worker node side, the very right side, you have kubelets, which more or less take over the role to orchestrate Docker or any other container runtime to start your processes. And this is what you should really, so this is the marketing, care about. You have the user side, the API, and the container cluster. Okay. This is not what we are doing on this kind of events and congresses. Let's look into it. My main message is Kubernetes is part of the DevSecOps landscape. DevOps is more or less dead, but it is revoked as GitOps, DevSecOps, SecDevOps, or configuration as code, as you want, how you want to name it. It's not well defined, and together with the typical stack of security, so confidentiality, integrity, accessibility, Kubernetes adds automation and, what most people don't know, the possibility to audit your cluster out of the box in the latest version. So this is, these are the missing things. And there is no good definition of DevSecOps. So for me, it's a philosophy. You take DevOps and add security to every step. And this means it's an educational process. It's about the mindset. And mindset needs to be implemented in wetware. So in your brain, it must be clear what's going on. And if you have a map, what all belongs to DevSecOps, this is a typical map. And you see Kubernetes is doing a lot of this stuff, and cloud providers, and you can write your own cloud with Kubernetes, need to do the missing part. Just to remember, this is a complex map, and we have to deal with it. So this is background. Let's go technical. What is a container? So it's often compared to a lightweight virtual machine. This is true and not true at the same site. For developers, it very often looks, it's a virtual machine. I can install everything in a container. From an operations point of view, it's the wrong approach, like you see on the right side. You can do it, but it does not fit very well. So from an operation side, you should follow the 12-factor philosophy, one process per container, and have a well-defined behavior that the containers can be controlled. So what are containers? Actually, for me, it's not only, oh, Docker is a container. Yes, it is, but containers are a way of isolating and restricting Linux processes. You do the isolation by namespaces, capabilities, and have restrictions like in the C groups or SecCom part of the Linux kernel. And the layout is what you have on the left side with virtual machines. Always needs a kind of hypervisor, typically QEMU KVM, where you have processes. You can emulate every operating system. On the right side, you see containers are running in the Linux process space, so there are real Linux processes, and the Linux kernel takes care about the isolation. Whereas on the left side in virtual machines, you have simply the Intel or other processors that guarantee that you isolate you with ring zero and other stuff. Linux namespaces are not so well known as intended. So here are the typical Linux namespaces. And you have all the namespaces. Most important, you can set the namespace per process individually. You can have processes in the same network namespace, which are completely isolated in a process namespace, which is a typical thing, which is something you have to have in mind, because Kubernetes pods are designed in a way that they share common network namespace. Capabilities are also something which is not so well known in the Linux kernel. These are 38 capabilities in a 64-bit array implemented in the kernel. And you have things like capnet admin, then you can change the network layout, can run IP tables, set up private devices, things like this capnet raw, which gives you raw access to the network. Capsysadmin is in root here. If you have capsysadmin for a process, it can do everything. Capsystime, for example, can change the time. In a container, you normally have the time, same time as in the host machine. So with capsystime, a container could change the clock. One word of warning, there is a lot of wrong stuff, and unfortunately even the Bundesamt for Sicherheit in der Informationstechnik does not know very well about containers in Kubernetes. So it's more or less 50-50 truths and true and false what they say about it. And unfortunately, even the EX article in the Heise magazine is not really helpful. So don't believe what's done there. Just think of your own. And this is going to explain the next is what is a Kubernetes pod? A pod is where you share the network capabilities. So network means you have in both containers the same local host and the same IP tables rules, the same DNS, the same whatever tunneling, if you do tunnelings, and everything can be separate. So one container could have access to a different part of the file system, definitely has different users or mount devices or process IDs. And this is an example. On the right side, you see the simple pod. It's just starting an Nginx server. You should simply know a single container is always a pod, but containers are really only good if you glue them together in a pod. This is an example where you can ensure, can secure an SQL connection with a WordPress server. So I don't like WordPress very much, but if you have to create a WordPress server, it needs access to a database. And here you see on the left side, the green part is how the WordPress server is configured to use a local host MySQL database. But it does not have a database running, so the right side is another container, which is a Cloud SQL proxy, which goes directly into the Google Cloud and connects you with additional credentials, which have a different life cycle than your passwords, and encrypt it and open a TCP proxy connection. The TCP proxy connection is secured. If you don't like the Google approach, the Cloud SQL proxy is open source. You can, as everything here is in this talk is open source, you can use it and redirect it to your own database cluster if you like it. It's not as difficult. So this is a use case where a pod makes the database connection more secure than before. The secrets are stored in Kubernetes, so here is a way of generating the username, password, secret for for the MySQL connection, and below you see the certificates and private keys for the Cloud SQL connection. So this is typical stuff if you set up a database in Kubernetes, in Google Kubernetes Engine, JKE. If you want to look deeper into this stuff, here are some things I can recommend. For example, if you don't like the BSI stuff, start with the NIST stuff. So the National Institute of Standards from the American government has published a very useful report, how to set up Kubernetes and other container systems secure. So the security architecture is based on a very subtle system with users, service groups, service accounts, namespaces, roles, role bindings, and then you have pod secrets, cluster roles, role bindings. All the blue stuff is just an object in Kubernetes. You can also connect the Kubernetes service accounts and all the stuff to the cloud. Identity and access management, IAM, this has to be implemented by your cloud provider. If you want to be your own cloud provider, I would recommend to implement it on your own. The next thing is pod security policy. It's more difficult because here you protect the local machine from something inside the containers, especially the data layer is important. If you configure Kubernetes completely wrong, then you get access to the host file system, and then a privileged container can do more or less everything. I have an example here how you can get access to, in a few minutes, how you can get access to a Docker socket. So this is a security system here. What you should thing what you should consider is setting up your own admission controller that you definitely control what's going on. The pod security policy implementation is an admission controller, so this is controlling the way you start pods in Kubernetes, and it even can change the configuration of a pod or refuse them. This is recommended things you should read. And if you start deployments, and one thing I showed you, the capabilities, Docker has a default set of capabilities, which in our opinion and most of the people is completely useless. So drop all the capabilities of Docker, which are mentioned there. For example, you have something like DEC override. This is a discretionary access control in Linux. It allows root to bypass file read, write, and execute permission checks if it's forbidden for root. In my opinion, Steve Grubb is absolutely right, and he says nothing should need this. This is complete nonsense. If your container needs this, it's probably doing something horrible. So please switch this off. The only thing you could use is a netbind service which allows your user space application to use privileged pods in the container. But if you use unprivileged pods, you don't even need this. Privileged, yes. The privileged system is complicated. And we have even things like the execve system can escalate privileges if you don't have a flag which says new privs added to prevent systems like this. This is in the Linux kernel 3.5. It's not a good idea. It's absolutely stupid idea. And it's exposed by Kubernetes. If you say, I don't want to do privilege escalation, then you don't get these privileges with the following exception. And this is weird. When the container is privileged, OK, I can understand this. When cap sysadmin is added to the container, makes sense. But when a container is not run as root, UID 0 is added, so this privilege is added to prevent breaking set UID binaries that you can do a sudo in a container, which is nonsense. This is complete nonsense. And you should switch it off. Unfortunately, you have to check it with this cat proc 1 status in the second line here, that it's not really getting escalated. Thanks to Andreas Peters Petty from Spiegel Online pointing to this issue. I've shared the link where this is discussed in detail. So what can go wrong with a mal-configured cluster? You all know the bash bomb. Here is the cloud bomb. If anyone has a Kubernetes cluster up to version 1.6, this probably will work. Don't try it in production. Still works in Minikube without protection. Here you can start from inside BusyBox, a Docker process, getting access to the Docker socket and running the Docker binary from inside a container, which is nice if you want to build containers in containers, but from a security point of view, it's a serious flaw, and it should be definitely turned off. So we have talked a lot about complexity, and everybody agrees complexity is worse enemy of security. This is a site from Bruce Schneier's interview in Hong Kong 2012. What he also says is, we absolutely love complexity. So this is not, I don't want this kind of thing. We have to discuss it. Effectively, my personal conclusion, it's a philosophical or religious discussion. What we need and what we want is different. So we can talk about this, but this is not a technical issue. And here's a network view. So you have been warned, more complexity. What you see here, the blue part again, is what happens in Kubernetes. And the example here is if you set up an ingress, which controls the way Kubernetes is accessed by the outside, you can use a certificate in your cluster. In the Google Cloud, it can be connected to regional or to the global load balancer, which is unseen, as I think. And then you get a global rule to your cluster, which means you expose a TLS certificate to the Google global load balancer, which is implemented as Maglev. This would be a talk on its own. And then you get a certificate. It takes 8 minutes or 10 minutes to get ready, and then Google injects the traffic into your network endpoint groups, which gives you 40 gigabit per second performance on the high end. So this is definitely what you want. On the other side, this complexity must be handled somehow. And if you want to write your own Kubernetes application for your own provider, you have to implement kind of custom controller, which definitely takes over these roles. On the light blue level, this is on the Linux level. You see here running containers. They are orchestrated through a container network interface. You have traffic rules. You have border gateway protocol and all this stuff. The bottom layer is the hardware, which is configured through your Kubernetes stuff. So it's, we have virtual machines, there's a physical fabric, software-defined network, virtual private cloud VPC, and things like this. So it's a perfect buzzword bingo what I'm doing here, but this is more or less the main part of the network system. Okay. What we do is the customers come to us, oh, we need more security, and then I started to offer audits, which means we look into Kubernetes clusters of our customer and give them advice what could be better and what should be fixed, or start with writing a security model. You don't even know what you want, so how can you implement something on security? These are the top findings. The first thing is storage, which is not part of Kubernetes. Then images, installations, pod security, audit logs, and networks. I will go through this. most pain point is everybody does distributed databases wrong. So here's a reason for it. If you want to have a positive talk, how you can do it right, look into the Berlin Buzzwords talk from Bloomberg. Houston Putman did it quite right, I think. And anything else is try to understand at least the theory. Distributed database has a cap theorem. You can only have two of these three parts. And replication is hard. Even if you do it with MongoDB, where replication is implemented the easiest way. So try to understand it. And databases are not 12-factor. Don't do it in Kubernetes if you are not knowing how to do it outside. Next thing are images. So you need image policies, registries, image stream, things like this. And what we see here very often is you are running code from an unknown source as root with full access to the cluster resources, which is a terrible idea. It was always a terrible idea. And this includes something like kubectl create minus f, which can be hijacked. This would be a different talk, but it's actually it's a 30 minutes exercise to do it on your own, to implement it in any language. If you want to learn Go, it should take 30 minutes. And take, I don't have time to go into the Helm chart part. It's the same for the Helm charts. Registries, you know, we have seen malicious code here. In 2014-15, there was Heartbleed and Ghost in images. And we would never forgive Microsoft for such a mess. And this was the problem. Two-thirds or three-fourths of the container there had high or medium priority insecurities in the Docker Hub in 2015. And you can protect it by adding special checks in your system in CLAIRE, or every cloud provider nowadays has something like that. And unfortunately, it wasn't better in 2018, and I would not give a coin on, or give a cent on that this is better now. So be aware, check your images. You have to set it up your own. The next thing is the cluster setup. Setting up a cluster is easy, but maintaining it under production level is hard. So keep the cluster up to date. You need 5 people for this. We only see 2 in the projects. You have to manage service accounts and users. Please automate everything in your system. Add further version and try to deploy on the latest version of Kubernetes always, because Kubernetes is narrowing the security. So it might be that you have an application which is not running on a future version because the security has increased. Pod security, add pod security to your system. Definitely limits, liveness, validity checks are best practices. Especially don't switch off SE Linux or AppArmor. Use the host file isolation. I show you something like this. If you want to check for privileges, this is a kubectl command, which is quite easy. Here can you check for the Kubernetes security context, especially in init containers. And this is a Go template version. And here you see the red things are, there is no such thing like security context. The greens have good ones. So this is a typical mini kube run. So it's quick and easy to check it. Check your runtime. So Docker is still the default, but it will change this year that Creo is a new default. Rocket is completely outdated. You can now, at least in the Google Cloud, have a one-click solution at GVisor. GVisor isolates the file system. On top, you see what you do on a typical system without GVisor. And with runtime equals run as C, you see GVisor is blocking most of the critical access in your system. So you can add it. And in the future, the good news is the runtime class will make it configurable. GVisor here, this is a restrictive pod security policy. Please apply something like this. This excludes everything. Allows only the important and secure volumes. and blocks the host network, host IPC, and things like that completely. So the good thing is, on the other side, you also can add audit logs to your system. For example, if you want to do DevSecOps in a healthcare environment, well, the game was you build it, you run it, and we have all Kubernetes YAML files in Git, secrets in a special secret branch. You can add the audits to things. Audits means you can see every time and somebody execs in a container or changes something, it's noticed and it's written to a logging system. In the Google version, it's Stackdriver. Then you can export it to BigQuery, and then an auditor can only use SQL queries and to inspect what's happening in BigQuery. If you don't like Google, you can also do it with Elasticsearch. Elasticsearch has a role-based access model on its own. You can use it and simply do it this way. Okay, next thing is the network. Network policy is a must. And what you see here is you can add Calico, which is add network policy in the Google Kubernetes engine by default. And here you have the picture every time something changes in the network configuration of a pod, the CNI, the container network interface, is called. And then it changes the network layout, which means changing the routes, border gateway protocol, IP tables, the entire physical fabric. It's actually very fast, but it looks complex. Network policies are like IP tables rules on labels, namespaces, and ports. So this is a typical network policy rule matching roles, like the database should also only be accessible by the front end. Things like this. So if you know IP tables, this is something you really get into. The next hot thing are service mesh. So buzzword is Istio. Again, it's a one-click solution in Google Kubernetes Engine. It allows private public mixed clouds, so like GKE on-premises. It's also necessary for Knative, so the serverless application on top of Kubernetes. It will be part of OpenShift 4. It has developed mainly by Google, IBM, and Red Hat, so looks important, big names, impressive architecture, should be secure. Let's look deeper into it. This is a picture from Istio. Shows secure, defense in depth, zero trust network, all the buzzwords. And what they are using effectively are sidecars. So here is the layout of the pod where you have the Istio Envoy container, which does the proxy work. And what they don't mention very public is they running an init container, changes the IP tables rules. And it's in user space, effectively. So it has a net admin capability. Net admin capability is, some people say, it's nearly like net sysadmin. And on the side, they also have a CA and Citadel and all this stuff. So let's look into it. This is a picture of a service mesh. So from Red Hat, you can configure everything. You're running sidecars. Sidecars control the network. Your microservice application is not able to escape the rules of the sidecar. Really. Here is how you can escape from the rules. So sidecars are used in user space, so you can revert it by simply running this IP tables rules from a different container, and it takes a Istio proxy container itself to remove these rules again. And here you see how we classically remove IP tables rules, and then all your network security is voided. And this is really a problem for the cloud. So you have added network security, but you have lost multi-tenancy, because if everybody who can deploy something like this can remove the network security, you have a problem. So it should be added at least support security policies that you are not allowed to do this. So I found this, filed a bug in January, included this exploit, set a disclosure limit of 6 weeks. I've forgotten the issue. Then I received an answer in March, so 8 weeks, okay, 7 weeks from Tao Li, Google Florida. And I was not the first who invented this bug, but I think this is a script kiddie approach. It has been confirmed, and he told me that in Istio 1.2, the container network interface will take over the thing. So the same thing, which is more or less not in user space, is done now, and the container network interface can be used and cannot be controlled from a user pod. So Istio 1.2 is ready now, but it's not rolled out everywhere. So the default is still a sidecar. So be aware that you have to fix something. Not many people are running Istio at the moment, fortunately. But in the future, we will see more of our customers doing these implementations with Istio. So the conclusion, it's lengthy, but actually, it's a lot of fun working with Kubernetes. And for me, it feels like working with Unix and Linux in the early 90s. So you see a lot of low-hanging fruits in security if you know the good old system engineering and you question the marketing slides, you can find a lot of flaws, I think. And I did not even look into the Go code. DevSecOps in generally is a good idea. We see it in our customers' projects, but don't forget the sec. If you dive deeper in a system like this, you will find flaws. It's inevitable. The flaws I presented here, the Docker flaws, are parts of Docker and not part of Kubernetes and part of the weird capability system of Linux, which simply should be cleaned up. You will see a lot of buzzwords, and you will see the typical thing, you focus on one security aspect, and then somebody has a backdoor and does something completely weird behind your back. Trust nothing, for me, it's a buzzword. You always have to trust somebody. You have to trust the code, you have to trust your cluster, you have to trust your users if they are doing. But okay, you can set up a trust no network cluster now. You can support it if you look deeper into it by writing and responsibly disclosing exploits. The community is really friendly and supportive, so you can get back some things. And that's everything what I wanted to tell you. So start using it. Use it responsibly, and just have a way of looking into the security. So if you have questions, try to stay all above all these clouds. I'm giving a workshop on this in the Sybase area at 3 p.m. So let's go for it. Okay, thank you very much. Questions?
Has anybody a question? Please raise your hand. Is there any questions from the internet? No questions from the internet? Yep. Okay, go right away.
What's the security issue with that Istio sidecar in particular? I mean,
actually, you can switch it off by deploying this NetAdmin container additionally. So it's just, it's in user space. You have trust your containers. If they would have done it right, they would have written an admission controller which does not allow a NetAdmin capability on its own and would refuse this kind of container and then add the sidecar container. It's just an internal attack. So you think you are secure, but you can simply remove all the security, so it's not so the proxy container is not controlling your connections. But I can show you the exploit working if you come to the workshop.
But the actual application itself is The actual application itself is still running unprivileged, right? So
Yeah. It's unprivileged, but for example, it can telephone to the home base, so it definitely can circumvent all the egress and ingress network restrictions.
Got so it. If you got project level permissions, me.
You don't need project level permissions. You need simply setting up this cluster, and then you do the Istio injection, and then you're off. This container is running after Istio has injected the security rules, and then it's removed again.
Thank you.
Well, welcome.
Please.
Hi there. Thank you much. That was a great talk. I'm a CNI maintainer, by the way, so hi. Have you seen Cube Let Me In? So anyway, we can talk about afterwards, but there are some well-known vulnerabilities in most Kubernetes providers. And if the project Cube Let Me In is scriptkiddies for Kubernetes, and it can exploit like GKE, OpenShift, those things like that.
I believe that is possible. If you collect all these things together, you have a nice collection of this kind of stuff.
So it would be really cool to see any more exploits you find. We can put them together.
Yeah, great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Please go on, but please talk a little slower. It's hard to hear on the stage.
Thank you for the talk. It was very interesting. I was wondering if there is any way to make Helm, the package manager, more secure, or you don't recommend using it at all?
What I would recommend is to limit Helm to a certain namespace. So you have a very well-known option, -- tiller namespace, and then you can inject this tiller application, which is really not necessary in the future. It will be removed in Helm 3.0. And then you have it in the namespace only, and then you can, the damage is limited to this namespace. So normally now it has full system access, and then you can remove everything, and this is a problem.
Any more questions from the internet? Okay, thank you very much. I close this talk now.
Thank you.
A big applause for Thomas Fricke.